lecture đều tổng mô tạo topic lecture đều tổng mô topic ưu tiên đề mô là eco-theology. So it's really looking at the relationship between God and the environment and our responsibility, our role as stewards of this creation. So it's helping them understand that link. The reason why I am in Tahoma now for about 4 years, the Chimbo Tango view is in Eric Tahoma, Abi. Abi? Not to be in that school. But to help them understand, you know, their issues and climate change. The reason for that is when I came back, I was doing consultancy work. The Prime Minister as a climate change advisor. But I realized the influence of the church on the community. Because us as government workers, when we go into the final, we tend to pretty much talk down on people. We're never at their level. But I've learned that from my experience doing research here in the Bukhara, that when you do research, you always have to pretty much know yourself, like you are not an expert at all, you don't know anything. And then I think that's important. When you're doing research, you really have to bring yourself down to the level of that. Because otherwise, if they, and I try to, that way you, then you get the information out. Otherwise, people get intimidated by being one of the other scientists and he knows everything. So they won't talk to you. Or if they do talk to you or with you, information is very different. But with my trips to the other islands, I realized the influence of the church, especially the Omi tours. They're actually more powerful than the government officials. And they tend to be the neutral one in the community. So he realized maybe earlier the importance of helping them understand climate change. And that I needed to get into Tahoma to teach them this. Pitch the idea to the principal and the executive. Agreed. So 2 years ago, I went into Tahoma. So I've been teaching there since. So I'm teaching again with this new law that comes through the idea now. Teaching about eco-theology. Eco-theology is a hard subject there because I'm not a theology person. And I rely on them to make the connections. But I teach them the other side, the science, the ecology, and help them then narrate it. Because in the Bible, there's talks about the environment. But we don't really focus on those things, So now, But their understanding of climate change and environmental issues are up there. And what I've noticed, the pupu, tuketurato understanding and their even turato stance on issues up than the older law. And I think it's really because wa'api, and that's the key. Because you wouldn't know what to do if you were never taught. The program that we just did, which is the Yoti Wangali. So that program is heavy on the environment. So we have these college kids go through they go through some programs that we've developed, like scuba diving. But the whole idea there is to help them see the environment. Because if we don't see it, how can we protect it? Because we don't understand it. But it's really to help them, expose them to that environment, help them see it. So Yotiwahane, we went into, you know, like coral identification. Because when we go, what we see is a bunch of rocks and some fish and, you know, some corals. But we did, they, all of those things have a name. So what we try to do is help them put names to these things, to these living organisms and that and their mind. When we did that, they started to see that environment where before they couldn't see it. The demo was just this. So the Hamadamaturi Api era to the owner, Ahamatara to the kitty. Now the Armaturukura, it's not like they're just swimming and just looking at each other. They're starting to realize, to recognize everything around them. And it just really changes your whole perspective of your environment. Mm-hmm. So the idea is to help people connect. But in the long term, if we are able to do that, we are able to achieve that, the decisions that we make in the future will be different. And that we will always take these things into consideration. If I do this, how is this going to impact that? If I start building here, what are the implications that are, and the repercussions that are, what are we going to do here to the downstream environment and ecosystem there? So it's really connecting us, our people, to their environment, to the, and through that, Tāro to Matori, that's one more the whole share. Because I think that's what's lacking. Even though a lot of us here, we grew up the same way. We all went fishing, we all went to the fighter. For some reason, I didn't know how we see the environment, even though we went through it. So the purpose of Atiyo and the Tāro really is to take it further. Like, Waitaro is not just a place where we plant that tar. But we have to understand it's a place where everything is filtered before it goes into the marine environment. So on that day, my tar will be the white poa. And the other day, it's the tato poa. Ma. Because if you want to tato poa, it's not designed in a way to take dirt or the nutrients out. It's supposed to be clean. Because the other tato is the animal, the ram or the cow. The cow gets a. Let me ask you guys this question. The other one is the cow, a cow, a man.
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 Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Man. Uses, of course, the sunlight to process photosynthesis to make food for the animal. And then the animal, its waste becomes food for that plant. So it doesn't need anything from the outside except the ocean water and sunlight. So to really get the akara mikoto, the akara tato, the ito tato pamona from space, because these satellites that we have in the opening the Earth, they have all these sensors on them that can use we can use to pick up all kinds of information, and we just have to ask, okay, I want this, and then when the satellite they may open it, that's again. So it can pick up the type of plants in the ocean. So me agaratato itetotato pamon, and that links to some of the reasons why we are considering deep sea mining. We're pretty much a desert. Because this environment doesn't need nutrients. We go to the nutrients, the money for. We took away the money for here to take, yeah, the thing got. But we took away the money for room with in more, yeah, the thing got it. Plants. Whatever you're focusing on, what the million to put there. Money what to do with the million, what the million. Same thing in the marine environment. If you put nutrients into the money into the marine environment, I took the room. So me agar me ra to tato the room with the satellite. there's no rim. It's just a desert. Because it's designed that way. But it did to Adora, because of development, and we, you know, we're in tourism, and Father Deonai, who are not talking to the report, the detail of money, but the detail of the area, we had issues in Muri, to Trim, not just Muri, but everywhere around the island, in the Mua. So, okay, it was just some of the things that, that we are doing. It's really bringing awareness to the environmental issues. And this is what Korero Oteoro, which is our NGO, focuses on indigenous issues and environmental issues. Yeah, whatever you need to tell, I really, okay, so maybe to go out to Norway for research. So when you think about research, you really have to have, first of all, you have to have a question now. You have to have one. But you can't just like come up with a question. When I went to school, when I went to graduate school in Mariki, and I took you to the APIA, and I noticed everyone is just reading, and there were students that are just reading paper after paper after paper. But they are out from the Catalonia. I don't like reading at all. And they just went paper after paper. And it's really just building their knowledge up on the topic that they are interested in.
Yes.
So, and when you have that foundation, then you can ask questions. Then you can ask a question, okay, you know what's being done, and what's out there, and the type of the research at the end of the year, and you can also identify the gaps. You need to know what's been done already. Either you take that research further to that's what science is all about, yeah, advancing from other, from previous works. And re-looking at what's been done already, but you have to be able to replicate what they did. And those that done the research before you have to do it in a way that can be repeated, replicated. Without research, then no one else knows how to do it. It has to be in a way that someone else can repeat. But that question is very important from the beginning. But as I mentioned earlier, you have to have some knowledge of the subject first before you even ask the question. Which means you have to do a literature review. So for example, my work, but this topic that I chose, which is Cigarette fish poisoning, it was something that I've always thought about because it affected me as a young person growing up here, because fishing was very much part of our family's life. We fish a lot. Weekend, my whole family would go fishing, whether it be takin patuki or net fishing, or kimieke, poro tarakote. So we grew up that way, not just my family, but even our neighbors. For me, it was pretty much a playground for us. And I, we don't like eating fish. It was later on that we started eating fish. But that activity for me, I think it was growing up, was fun. But in Tupuanga, the fish poisoning, all of that was gone. Because everyone was scared of fish poisoning. But we didn't know what was going on. And even though at the time, our neighbor was experienced with, like, they've had it since the 1950s, yeah. Since the 50s. So they already experienced fish poisoning before us. But because we never really, they never shared that information. They come back with the herbal remedies. But we experienced the same thing with even the researchers. But anyway, then the So that went with me as I went through school. As I was studying, that question was always in the back of my head. And then when I started reading about it, about fish poisoning. That became my dissertation, so that question is very important to us. Category 4 and 5. Cyclone Sandy was barely a 3. It was really a 2. Now, Martin, the true level of Martin, but they muddled with the Martin.
But the terms, what's that?
So sequel. Sequel is really a, it's a Spanish word. Sequel is a snail. I think that the Aimuero, Ama Emerato, Lutheran Ayari, Kitina Yumi. Yeah, so Amatato, for example, they are the organism, the plant, microscopic plants that causes fish poisoning. So fish poisoning is a natural thing. It's caused by a microscopic plant that naturally occur in the marine environment. So we can't really see the name over here, but yeah, I don't know, fish poisoning will come here. Gambia discus toxin. So that's the genus and the species. So the genus is the name, is the first name, and then the species is toxins. So there are different types. All of these are called dinoflagellates. Dinoflagellates are these microscopic plants with a tail. They have a little tail, you can't really see that. That helps them swim. But they are naturally occurring in the marine environment. They're the ones that are producing the toxin. But how do they get into the food web? They settle, or they live on the surface of the limu that you see in the on the reef. They will limu rau rau, they will limu uma uma. They move on around the limu at the surface of the from everywhere they think of, the limu. And through that, microscopic. Plants, and they are releasing these toxins. So, Magadatu di Imu, can you guys figure out where was it? Where did it come from? So, Gambia discus. That's the. So, where do you think that name come from?
France.
Yes.
French.
Spanish.
French Polynesia. French Polynesia. You guys find out the Gambia Islands? Gambia Islands in French Polynesia. That's where it came from. So first to stop it there. Idratuato the 1950s, 1960s. Poisoned the French Polynesia, and there was a suggestion that it's linked to the nuclear testing.
Yeah.
They did that over a period of 30 years. So far there is nothing linking it to nuclear testing. For one, really hard to do research in French Polynesia, especially if you have to link it to nuclear testing. Because you have to apply, every time you go into a country, you have to apply for research permits. And I think they will know everyone that goes and like start linking things to nuclear testing. Deny it with the French government. But there is some suggest that it might be linked to that. Although these dinoflagellates or these plants, they're natural in the marine environment. For some reason, some argue that there's a mutation that's causing them to be toxic. However, fish poisoning is not new. It was reported during Captain Cook's visit to the Pacific in Vanuatu. And then Captain Columbus also reported in the Caribbean area. So it's nothing new. It wasn't for Ciguatera at the time, but the description of the symptoms fits Ciguatera. So it's not new. So my research was really asking the question, really looking at the history of Ciguatera poisoning. So the approach is multifaceted and multi-pronged. approach. I don't care about the way, how it ties in with the reef, but also look at like archaeological studies. Then I went and did questionnaire surveys, looking at the asking questions of the community. So these, when doing a PhD, you can't just have one topic. You have to have different chapters on the same subject, but you have to ask several questions.
I was just interested in
the multi-pronged approach. Like, to get the other way, stop it from one.
Yeah, I understand what it means, but it's just that.
The multi-pronged approach. Because I don't get that you are. I don't want to talk about this because, to be honest, because for my area of study, the science, we use the scientific approach, scientific method. And we tend to skip all the other areas that are also important, like ontology and epistemology. We don't look at those things. It's like we were trained to go straight into the scientific method. Yeah, we skip all the other stuff. So when I went through school, we were always taught this method, the scientific method. You have to have a question, you have to have a hypothesis, you have to develop your method, how to answer your question, and then interpret your information, then your conclusion. So it's a very different approach. Yeah. Because I just realized that reading through some of the other disciplines, their approach is very different. They pretty much look at how it's supposed to be done, like from the beginning. Whereas we skip all that and go straight into the scientific method.
But Sandra, don't you think that you as a Cook Islander growing up here, you approached it as a Cook Islander because you knew the context of you?
Yeah.
You knew how you had to approach it with people and
yes.
The pumps, the methods, like the water owners and those sorts of things?
I think that was my advantage going into what I went into. Because my thinking was very different from all these other students from the US. Some of the students that I went to school with, I went to these Ivy League schools in the US, a friend of mine went to MIT. And then their fellow of Yale. But I remember, I'll just share this, the first year, I pretty much on the verge of giving up. Because I took this writing course, advances in technology, in ecology, and there was lots of writing. And sometimes like, we would write an assignment, and then we give it to the person next to you. And then we did that several times, and I realized, my writing was so simple. compared to theirs, who like couldn't understand what they're writing, and it was so complicated, and the terms they use, and I mean, I would want to write like that, but I can't because I have double level of vocabulary and everything is so hard. So I try to write as complicated as I can. So I went to the professor and I said, I don't think I'm up to this, and because my writing is nowhere near these other students, my colleagues. Then the roommate got away. Did you understand what they wrote about and what they assigned for? No, I didn't know school. If you didn't understand, it means they didn't write it properly. So by the end of the semester, all of them were writing like me. simple. So, and I think science have changed over the years. Now, when you read scientific papers, anyone can understand.
Yeah.
Mais even more, it's like when you read, if you compare the literature now to the literature before, you won't be able to understand that literature because it's so written in a way that only smart people will understand. So there is a shift, and especially in science. And scientific publications now are easier to read compared to those in the past. So we were made to read all these papers. They were prepared from even from 1800, and then added all the way. You can see how it's changed over the period. But the local knowledge is very important. I think for me, the my advisor always tells me it's just a different way of learning. So for me, because I'm studying coral reef. That I've already walked through the jungle and I'm just learning about that jungle. Whereas those other students, they've never been through the jungle. They're learning about the jungle before they even walk through. So it's just, you know, but at the end we'll all get to the same place. But just that difference for me, I think it also influenced the way you think. Now, because when I came up with this paper, so I wrote this paper on this paper is published in the Journal of Biogeography. And this paper talks about the migration of the Polynesian people. And I linked it to this. Did the Polynesian Tsugatera prompt the lake? For the migration now of our people, because I think it was a period about 700 to about 1,000 years ago, there was this explosion out of the homeland. Now in Polynesia, the homeland is considered French Polynesia. It was there, so we migrated from Samoa Tonga to East, but there was a long break up, because before that, if we go further back, 5,000, 4,000 years ago, Akabato Metato is Southeast Asia, so the Tamanoa is Taiwan.
Yes.
Poe Metato, through Akabato Metato, Samoa Tonga, Fiji, there was a long pause there. Tamanoa, it took about 1,000 years before we crossed the French Polynesia. But when we got there, we realized there's this huge ocean to the east. But I thought the island to the east. It was later on, and I think at that time, then that 1,000-year break, we started developing the common technology and then navigation and all that. Because before that, with Aramaonato, the sea level was actually low. At one point it was like 100 meters lower than it is today. So what that means is some places they walk across. So there was really no need for an advanced technology in terms of voyaging. At Manuelate Manga Pato, that's where you see it in one. But it was when they got to Samoa Matongama that they encountered this huge ocean. It was then that they developed the technology. Anyway, so the publication here, the Karamaro Kiroe, it was fish poisoning that contributed to their migration. That was my question. The question is, did that prompt the migration? Did Tsugatera prompt the migration? So, asking that question, I had to go and look for information to support it up. So I started going into archaeological studies that's been done in the Cook Islands. I know what happened today, I know what caused it, and I know the impact on our people, because the time when Tsugatera occurred started in the 90s. Heavy Tsugatera in the 90s, Akamata they really do it poison. And then Taiyi, what happened in 96? You guys remember what happened in 96? What was an event that marked 96?
Oh, yes. Yeah, but like other around the Pacific, they came here.
Oh, that's the festival, eh?
Yes.
That was in 1992. Yeah. So what happened in 1996?
Bankrupt.
We had a financial crisis, eh? So yes, then yes. People were laid off. Then our people started migrating.
Yeah.
So they can't have new kill away. If Cinque Terre contributed to the migration, maybe minimal, I don't care, because there are other factors to consider. But if you look at the ones that migrated, they're really from the lower income bracket of the population now. Those are the ones that relied on our marine resources to supplement. But because the fish is poison, they can't afford the home beef. But they can afford to leave, though. but they started voyaging, eh? But I think I thought, okay, because we have that New Zealand citizenship, it was easy for us just to get on that plane with leave. Now, if we didn't, if our situation was similar to Samoa, where you have to be special, you have to have some rugby skills in order to be accepted into New Zealand, that would be harder for us to leave, eh? We have to stay here and fight it out. But because we're New Zealand citizens, it was easy. So I asked myself, okay, if this was maybe a small factor that contributed to the migration, fish poisoning, can you imagine if the same thing was to happen 700 years ago? If 700 years ago they were hit by Cinque Terre poison, there was no corned beef, no tin fish to turn to, and no But the similarity that I drew from that is that, okay, we have the citizenship, we have a passport to easily go into New Zealand. Back then, they had the technology and the knowledge to navigate. It was easy for them to hop on their canoe and leave, because they can. You know, as we know now, you know, we're trying to revive this whole knowledge on navigation. But even though we lost it, but if you can see what's involved, it's amazing, huh? Because at the time where our people were migrating thousands of kilometers, miles from where their home is, the Vikings, because the Vikings were doing the same thing, but they were just going from coast to coast. And to that point, they were like, So they were pretty advanced in terms of voyaging compared to their counterpart in Europe. Really, it's the Vikings. So, but those, I mean, that was one of the questions I asked, really. If that was to happen 700 years ago, would that have had a huge impact on the people? Then I started looking at archaeological evidence. Are there evidence to suggest that that actually happened? So, lucky, some archaeologists have done some work in Hune, like Stucky, Muturako. Muturako, it's like an archaeological site. That site's been studied by several archaeologists. But one in particular, Ellen, she did her PhD here. I don't know, maybe, do you guys know Belinda Ellen? What's the PhD? I think she comes back now and then. She was the one that did a lot of study, really good study. But what they found, they saw a change in the type of fish that was eaten by our people then. But they couldn't explain why. So what they saw is there was a shift, a complete shift of the type of fish they were eating. They didn't like see any information on like a reduction in size over time. When you see that, maybe 100 years ago, then over time, they started eating the same type of fish, but smaller one. Can you guys? What do you think is happening? When we see the size of the fish getting smaller and smaller, what is causing that?
The
carbon
emissions.
Overpopulation.
Overfishing. fishing.
Overfishing. Because you know when we fish, we start with the big ones. And then all the big ones are gone, then we start moving down. So if you see that, it's overfishing. But they didn't see that. They just saw this complete shift. So they were eating all these snackers and chocolates, and then they were eating buzzy. So the question is, but they couldn't explain why. And generally, if you're in one field, you stay in that field. It's like an understanding that disciplines have among themselves. It's like you're not allowed to go into other disciplines. But what I did, and that's where the multi-pronged approach came, is I went into other fields and to get information. Normally we stay within our area of interest. Like if I'm a marine ecologist, marine ecology, all of that world. But I started going into archaeology and I started going into the other field to find these links out. So when this work was published, the people that I referenced in that, they weren't really happy. part of the reason is they were angry at themselves for not making that link. But they wouldn't have been able to do that because they didn't understand all the other things that was going around. So I came and I cracked that thought and said, this is what happened. So that shift, we know from our experience today, TTR, right? TTR, Chukali, high-risk, snappers, with the tunnel, the Amir, high-risk. And we know we stay away from those fish. I mean, like the Titi, the Urwa that are in the harbor, they're nice to see, but we all know that we don't touch that fish, right? So for them, I think through trial and error experience, getting poisoned, they were able to determine the type of fish that you stay away from and the ones that you can eat. And so there was this complete shift. So that kind of supported what I was trying to allude to in terms of my questions. But not only that, so there was the archaeological support. So I started going into the climate side to say, okay, we know what happened today, what was driving all this secretary poisoning up. So really it's tied to disturbance. So because one thing about these dinoflagellates or these microscopic plants, they're what we call opportunistic. So only when the environment suits them, they come up, they turn up. And these organisms, these plants, they're always competing. There's always a competition on the reef for space. And they are poor competitors on the reef. But they turn up, or the opportunity arises when there is a disturbance. The good competitors, so if you look at the hospital records, every time we get a cyclone, after the cyclone, there's a spike in the hospital cases. So, and it's because these guys don't turn up, and over time, they get outcompeted, and so their numbers drop. So every time when there's a cyclone, their numbers go up, and they get eaten by the fish, and then over time, drops. So, pretty much did that research. So, I got that with the grandfather. Graphs are really important to interpret your dark side as a visual interpretation of your information. How do we look at this? So you look down here on the axis, low, high disturbance frequency. What that means, yeah, the putu or the low, allora te poi sindica me hai being a chicken di un anno mani a tutto con il poesia was that problem was up to so now that in 2005 there was like 6 cyclones that came through our region now, that's why it spiked because like room with the room with the room with it so the poison was always around now if the disturbances frequency is high they're always going to be around because tra taman manata the corporate or the food ones are the good competitors on the reef of these organisms that produce the bottom of the so I started looking at the climate link and found that Ratsuato migrated on the Kutato East Tonga. It was a time where the disturbance frequency would have been high. And that's tied to something I don't want to talk about that now, but have you guys heard of El Nino? El Nino and La Nina? In the Southern Cook Islands, when we go through an El Nino condition, we tend to be cool and dry. If we look at what's happening right now, we are going through a condition, it's the opposite condition, it's called La Nina. La Nina, the Epato Narco and Tobio Maribana La Nina, we tend to be warm and supposed to be wet. Because the warm, the Amino Dato Nemana, there's a lot of evaporation from the ocean, and you know, the Charangi is warm. But what's happening right now at Rotorua?
Just warm.
So it's not always true, eh? But to go and scare, that's how it's supposed to be. But for sure, Tanuki is the north. So, Tato, ito Tato Pamona, it's good at the name. It stretched up and down. Yep, they fit their bottles here. Arrotato from about 10 degrees north to about 2022. But our exclusive economic zone kind of extends out of that day. I don't know why I stopped over there. Fish that we eat compared to those in the U.S. Because I was giving this presentation to a bunch of Americans, so I have to make it relevant to them as well. But this is us, this is how much fish we eat.
No, it's double that.
Depends on where you are.
Talk about meaning in India.
But you know, because fish is an important protein now. So because we stretch up and down, we experience different climate conditions between the north and the south. So right now because it's a La Nina condition, we're supposed to be warm and wet. This Urato is supposed to be dry. So all of this maybe another time, all of these shifts in climate is determined by a really important factor. It's called the trade winds. What is the trade? You guys know where the trade winds come from?
East.
From the east. From the easterly, so it can be northeast, southeast, east, but it comes from this side. And it's really is the intensity of the trade wind that determines where rain is going to be, where the fish is going to be, all of that. And it's what also determines whether we are in a La Nina condition or an El Nino condition. So the trade wind is so important for us. And we use the trade wind for navigation and So that was the question about the, in terms of whether the Secretera prompted the migration of our people out of the homeland just from me. But at the same time, when I did this, when I wrote that paper, because, you know, I did some reading about all the other papers that have been done, all the other writing that have been done about the migration, none of them came from Pacific Island people. So I was kind of like, hey, we should be writing our own stories. We shouldn't let these people write our stories. We should be telling our stories. So, you know, that was all the And I still encourage that we stop there, not just us, also our Pacific that we should be writing our stories. The internet that And I think that's something that I've learned from my research, especially when I went out and did the questionnaire survey. When some women goes and do the survey, they get a different information. And when a Maori goes, totally different information. I did get. Because I mean, there are two things. I'm not talking about the Islam, and I had an argument with my anthropology professor when I was because they got on the giveaway. Whether they are good or not, it's not that everything we do is not not right in their eyes, and so we tend to be a bit reserved when we're actually talking with a papa. So the other thing I learned, there was this documentary that was done by TIS on the Maro 2 in Mitchell. When they did that documentary, they did it in English, not the UNESCO. And I came after and did a similar one, pretty much the same thing. The information was very different. So that just confirms that, you know, when you are doing questionnaires, you have to be mindful of that, that there is that reservation as well. Especially in the added square to the as opposed to interviewing as well. But there's also that element, that factor that I mentioned earlier, that you have to bring yourself all the way down. And because really, when you think about it, you are not the expert, they are. So you need to treat it that way, because you really don't know anything. And I have noticed that, I don't know if you guys, any of you have spoken to Papa Yon Peta?
Yes.
No,
yes. Yes.
That guy is full of knowledge.
Yes.
And I was surprised me. It's like stuff that we learn from the textbook.
Naturally.
How would he have known all that stuff? But it's because these people are totally stuck. Some of us over here have done the same thing. We're always out there. Because science is based on observation now. And earlier, your scientist said it's more of a snapshot. And we look at that thing and then we draw a conclusion. Whereas you are always there. Always there. You see the changes. You know? But we don't really, we're not writing about these things. And then today, that transfer of knowledge is compromised. So, because one, BC Rotato. Rotato Tato hold to talk with our kids, spend time with our children, pass that knowledge. So it's disappearing. So like I said, how we see things is very different from how someone else would see it. So when it comes to research in the Kupalan, I think you are in a more advantage over others. And I think I look at Papa around to that whole area in these areas. Because I think for a long time we've been focusing on economic development, tourism. And that's part of the reason why Porero Oro is doing all this work. Because we're seeing that gap. And we don't like the decisions that are being made today. Mm-hmm. And so in order to change that, we will focus on the kids. Mm-hmm. That's a long-term approach. And for the last 3 years, we've seen the change in the kids. like get at the altitude, get a lot of, and the way they learn is very different from how we learn. That's one thing I noticed. Like they're too torn up with me over there. They're too morado down at the phone and they're talking to each other. But when it comes to test, and you don't like that as a teacher, I bring this girl, I eat with them. But then when they test, I pass the hard. So I think that they have a different way. They have all the multitasking they hit, not us. So I think we have to take those things into consideration. I know this is about even the program which you are on. They are in the good, they have to go by and they're not going on at the chest. Everyone passed. So it's just like, I don't understand this. But they're also listening to you. I don't know, do you guys notice the same thing? I mean, really doesn't happen. We want them, we want all their attention. But they are able to multitask.
That is happening in the classroom.
Wow.
So it's like becoming a role kiamato. Right now, the teachers of today, not the ones before, no, you can see the difference. But all the teachers that are still in school now. Well, I think at times, you know, because I've asked that question, well, I look at them, when you get angry, you can't get to them, you know, especially the bigger ones. I think that's the way to keep their brains alive, looking at this and they are listening to you, but their faces are not looking at you, their faces are not looking at you, but their ears are sharp, and with all these things, the gadget, or, you can't just pick it up, all the earphones, so it's a moment, it's trying to shake the earphones out.
This, I just want you guys to see this. So that was our situation. So this is really a 3D image of the poisoning throughout the Pacific. And this is us here. This was our situation in 2005-2006. It went off the charts. So people are still, a lot of researchers that are working in this field, in this area of toxicology, they still reference this work that I did. So now and then, so I have a way of being alerted to when the work is cited. So I always get the, like every time someone used my reference my work, and then the work is published, I get alerted. I have an alert from Google search or from the Google scholar, somebody. I don't know how I got into that. But I always get email from them. Say, hey, your work has been cited, and then you get to read the paper. I know one of the attitudes of the research that I did, but I think I did touch on it. So I know about the fire thing, also there was a lot of work done.
So you used to have a section of the different sort of that.
Yes. I have different questions up. I don't care if they want to question now. And I have different ways of approaching those questions. But that's at that level, at the PhD level. Because you have to write several chapters. So but before you do all that stuff, so you have a question, and then you pretty much have to bring that question to your advisor, and then you then develop a proposal. How do you tackle that question? So when I did mine, it was a 163-page proposal. I didn't realize that how much I wrote, but I just looked at it again today and I was like, I forgot it. But at the time it wasn't even worth it. Because when you're interested in something, it really all the that doesn't matter to you.
Survey, you know, the participants,
there's over 600 individuals within their survey in Ahora. Mm. That's a lot of people. So after all, that's what I have to do. The interview on birthday, the little community hours. You know, they have the information.
Okay.
But you'll be able to do your own data.
Yeah. No, that's a good question. But before we even get there, so because this is science, we're very heavy on statistics. And when you do a questionnaire survey and you have a sample, statistically, you at least 5% of the population.
Oh.
Yeah. So we tend to set that just above 5%. The population, and we're looking at residential population now. That was on the morning. So, from a statistics standpoint, you always have to be 5% or more. Otherwise, our question here, our data, if you collected only 3% of the population.
Mm-hmm.
So, the higher the better, but 5% is the minimum.
Yeah,
of your sample size. That's really important. Like I said, like it's really the science, because the science is heavy on statistics. As opposed to, I think other fields do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. When you have to gather data,
mm-hmm.
Yeah, we all use statistics. No one likes statistics. I don't know. I don't know if anyone enjoys statistics. Some people are really good at it. Mm-hmm. I took that course like 3 times.
Yeah. You're not just focused on the specific area you are studying at that, or the health there.
Yeah.
The impact of the fish poisoning on health people. That you are going to go to the fire department here.
Your focus is poisoning, like fish poisoning, but because fish poisoning is impacting, it's very much cross-cutting air trade to the economy. The poison you without air, without air now. So that becomes a problem. And also on our health care system, the overrapport area tattoo, even though the overrapport poisoning, either you get a bunch of Panadol or
what's that?
IV, the Onjuka. Yeah, Utrawa, I think Utrawa, and then Tatato Gramu Mori. That's one of the things that I noticed. The doctors, especially the new ones, they're doing Tatu Guruva now. Fish poison, a lot of the doctors don't, like, especially the new ones, idea of fish poisoning, but until it's really bad, then we go to the hospital.
Yes.
Yeah, but I think 70 to 80% of the cases are not going to the hospital. So that's huge. No one can, they have their own remedies, they have their ramomori, and there's a range of ramomori. It's like, it makes you wonder how they come up with these ramomori.
Yes.
And there's one that's a whole bottle, you shake it until it's flat, and then you drink it. But it really, if you look at the medicines, so that the people, the remedies, they're either very bitter or very sweet.
Yeah.
So the sweet ones, it helps your body relax. Yeah. The bitter one, some suggest that it helps your body reject the toxin. Yeah. Was it Utsu did that?
Utsu, yeah.
Were you guys doing that one?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was shocked. So I was like, maybe someone tried to commit suicide and they because everyone knows that that's a poison. So who tried it? Only they found a supplement, fish poisoning, couldn't handle it. Decided to commit suicide, but not meeting me. I don't know who you are.
Oh,
More of a comment first. It was very interesting when you explained the documentary that was done by TIS, and then you did the follow-up. The same questions, the same but language was the difference, and you got different results. And I'm thinking that can have massive implications. So for myself, considering ethnographic research methodology going forward, and last week we learned from Tina Newport, she did an immersive research approach. So it does sound like the language that you use to conduct your research is so, it's such a massive, and has a massive consequence on the results of your research. So I think it's very just something that I myself am considering very strongly as a massive factor in my research.
Yeah.
Approach.
I was here for a presentation by a student from, I think he was doing his master's. And he was in Rahama, archaeologist. And I was looking at the way he did it there. Because at the same time, I was also there looking at the same thing, but his one, he really took it to the next level. He did analysis. But I remember with Amal, results, very different, it's the same thing, very different. And I did bring that up with them, that you have to really have to be careful about your interpretations, especially when you're dealing with indigenous groups.
Was he Papa? Was he Papa?
American student. Yeah. because it wasn't the same as what I collected from. He also did a questionnaire survey. This was really new, because of the climate stuff there.
So I think
very different.
One of the things when I do my presentation, I'll talk about being an outsider and speaking with young book islanders. And one of the ways that I was aware of exactly what Tina is talking about was we got some funding from WHO and we trained 5 young book islanders who were from first language speakers to do the interviews. So I interviewed, we interviewed 674 young people, which was about 20% of the youth population at the time. But anyone that wanted to be interviewed in Māori was interviewed by somebody fluent in Māori. And so that's a way, that if you are aware of your outsiderness, which is, I think, one of the things that many people are not thinking about, and that's why we need to consider these indigenous research questions.
Yeah,
because you will get the very different findings.
That's very
good. You walk the forest here compared to the other students at that time then. I think that's what you need to say, I said, right? Tahu yang mai yang kita tahu tema. I know it's a hard question. I know it's all got to do with modern technology. So I know really I'm a day after day, we have to know quite a bit of the Talma, the Tsunami, and keep your own mental to tell your love.
Experts at it, who get at me, can come in and also so that Tamato we try argue and get to the interview, we say Maramona will not work until we teach our people. And the way to do this is really to connect our people to that environment and for us as individuals to have a relationship with that environment. Mother is always starting to teach them to recognize corals, recognize fish.
Yes.
And the function of these different ecosystems. Because when you have that knowledge, I'm sure they'll think twice when it comes to like, okay, let's go and do this.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know, I'm going to do the interview as I'm going to get in
normal. Yeah.
You guys see the...
Open.
It was good, but okay, the water is open. The other way, they're really smart. And, but one thing I noticed though, and I sometimes at Blayman, I had a meeting in this with all the homes and you know how we do this gender balance thing. Really, we've been pushed to one side now. If you look at our, it's our boys that are vulnerable now. So, and we see that in our program. And I've spoken with a lot of them. It's like a grand idea, our boys there, we are not smart enough. No. That's for smart people. And then, I was shocked. And then there was a few of them that did the same thing. It's like they believe they can't achieve that.
Yeah.
And then I had to tell my story. And then, just to help them, But I don't know, but I think part of that reason is the parents that are telling them that, and like, hey, you need to go and work to take that alone, or contribute to
I thought I would go back up and research the science, like
Tapi spirituality of women of that. It has a lot of virus. It is already here. The already, you put it open and you put it out of the ship. The one that you want to talk about, the other half of the hour, the other half of the ship. The only thing you have to do is.
No. How people look at you, like whether they're going to be intimidated or not. That's the idea. But I think the most important thing, and I'm talking about like all these, like the awareness that we do in your area with the community here. First of all, you really need to understand your topic. Because you're not going to be able to explain something if you really don't understand it. And if you really understand it, you can tone it down. Like, to the level of the tomariki, the wrong quality, but that's one thing I noticed, especially in the technical fields that you put in Iraq on here. The wrong way that they are put on that, and you told me the department here. But because of the terminologies that they use, they're not able to explain it. But really, the bottom line is they really don't understand what they're talking about. So PPM Radotia or Big Words Aggregator, but for me, that was really the most important thing. First of all, you really need to understand the subject, topic you are talking about. Really, as if you understand it, you can go up and down and at the different levels of when you explain these things to people. So for me, when I talk about climate change and then all these climate cycles that Aaron was with the very little kids, Aaron was at the conference among scientists there. So, but that's really the key. I think that's from graduate school, I think that's what I've learned. That before you even talk about things, you really need to have a good foundation and understanding of the topics. Otherwise you're going to be just repeating what you heard from someone. You can't explain it in your own words.
When I listened to you talking about how you were going to give up on your course or whatever you were trying to achieve, to me, it's telling me that we can do it too. Yeah. If you can do it, we can do it. No, so I like the value you used, like how you said, to lower yourself down. So, and I feel that value you used was being humble and being respectful. And I feel that reflects back to us as humans, as teachers, how we have to understand how each child will, how you approach yourself to someone, like treat them how you would like to be treated. So that way you build that relationship to get your answers in it, you know, get their knowledge and skills. So I'm complimenting and I feel, you're showing us something, but and I was interested in listening to presentation. And you didn't just reflect just on the marine, but going back to our ancestors, coming down to our children, which was very interesting. and it's giving me ideas on how to approach it, you know? So, and I like how you, I mean, I listen to your other guys pronounce those words, those big words, those French words, I suppose. As I like it how you explain about it. And I think it's also reflecting to us humans, you know, like the wave. If it's not being without the, you're not, say, example, but happy in that, you know, there's ways you have to find to overcome those things or to find a result to, yeah, to find your answers in that. Yeah, I appreciate
that. Yeah. We might have to finish, people, because we've got Kati and then we've got a meeting with Ake at 11. Okay, so.
12.
Very good. Yes. Okay, 12. Thank you. I know it's. Alright, okay.
Again,
just a couple more questions.
Yeah, push it.
They have people so they have to have
of course, it depends on what you're studying. So like I said, my field was like very much new to a lot of people, even to my committee and my advisor. So when I came back here, to